Hello students, so today we are going to learn about chapter 3 of the class 8 history textbook, that is ruling the countryside. In this chapter we will know that after having the Diwani of the Bengal, we learned in the chapter 2nd, what did the English do to further their trade interest? What did the English do as being the chief economic administrator of a province? What did they do with this power which they did not had until now? So let's see, how did the English, they ruled the countryside? East India Company becomes the Diwan. So we all know that in August 1765, the East India Company was granted the Diwani of Bengal by the Mughal Emperor. So what they did with this Diwani, they became the chief economic officer. That means that they had now all the control of the revenues that was generated from their area of Diwani. So basically, if I am a Diwan of this province, which is some so and so area, all the revenues that will be that will come from there will be mine to have. And now what I do from that revenue is my own personal accord. So this is Robert Clive accepting the Diwani of Bengal in 1765. Now in your books, it has been shown that it has been written that he might have, you know, accepted this Diwani in his own tent, you know, very small affair. But it has been shown here by the painter as a very big affair with people witnessing. So with every of these pictures, what the East India Company, what the Britishers, they tried to show was that this was a majestic affair. Like the Indians, they themselves were willing to give us the power that we are going to behold, to give us all the responsibilities that they would like us to have. So basically, they wanted to show the willingness of Indians as well as the majestic appearance of the Britishers as well, being all capable and strong and being a very capable leader who were to take India in the path of civilization and modernity. So this is what the English always try to show with the paintings, being all majestic and everything. Now, revenue for the company. As we all know that after they were granted the Diwani of Bengal, they had the access to all the revenues that was generated by the province of Bengal. The aim after having this new Diwani was to increase the revenue. Of course, we all know that East India Company, they were initially traders, and their foremost responsibility and their foremost obligation was to the trading itself. They wanted to make more and more profit. Administration and everything was behind that. But first, they wanted to increase the revenue and gain more profit. And to buy, and how were they going to do that? They were to buy fine cotton and silk cloth. So initially, they were very, very interested in the trading of the cloth market. They were not as interested in the spice market till here. They were more interested in the trading of the textiles. And they wanted to have these textiles as cheap as possible. Like if they could not have these in a very cheap rate, then they would have to, you know, sell it on a rate that would not give them so much of profit. So if they take it, if they buy it cheap here in this country, then they will have the opportunity to sell that in their own country at a very high rate, and the difference will be theirs. So basically the profit will enhance. But the company was unwilling, even after being the economic administrator. Now, as being a Diwan, it came with a lot of opportunities and responsibilities. Opportunities they exploited. Like if I am going to have the revenue, I am going to exploit it for the profitization of my trade. But what about the responsibilities which came with the Diwani? They had to now devise a regular system of assessment or collection, which was very, very pertinent, because when you form a new administration, when you want things to work your way, then you have to devise a certain uniform way, a certain way which has assessment and, you know, a regularity in your sense only. Then only you'll be able to collect the revenue. Then only you'll be able to implement all the policies that you want. Basically, they were not willing to do this. They only wanted to exploit the other area, that was the profitization area, and they were not very willing to improvise a regular system for the assessment and collection of the revenues. They wanted that whatever system is prevailing then that time, that only should continue, and in turn they should have more profit for us. So this had, we all know, we learned in the previous chapter, that this had a huge implication on them. because before this Diwani, they needed to import gold and silver to buy the raw materials, to buy the silk and cotton textiles from India. But now since they had this Diwani, the revenue was enough for them to buy these clothes. So they wanted more and more revenue so that they could buy more and more of these products and they could send it back to England and gain more profits in their will. Trying to show yourself as majestic, we have seen the picture of Robert Clive taking the Diwani. So trying to show yourself as a very majestic power can have, you know, two implications. First, they wanted to show that how the people, they were very willing to give this Diwani to us. And secondly, they, when they went back home, they also wanted to portray themselves as, you know, very able administrator. So their popularity in their own country would enhance bifold. Now, there came a time when there was economic crisis and the famine of 1770. So before this, when the English, when the East India Company, they had the Diwani, they tried to, you know, buy, they tried to coerce the artisans, they tried to coerce the peasants into having cheap products from them. So basically, they coerced the artisans to selling the East India Company at a very, very cheap price. Because of this, the artisans did not had the motivation to come to the city and, you know, sit at the market and sell products. So basically, they were now withdrawing the amount of the revenue that was collected by the English in the province of Bengal was increased four times because they coerced these people to, you know, sell the products at a very cheap rate, and they were selling it at a very, very high rate and gaining much, much more profit. Of course, they were also coercing for a great revenue. Because of that, all the farmers, all the peasants, all the artisans, they were slowly withdrawing from their profession and they were not in a very able position to, you know, have the market like they were having in old times. So that was also a problem. In 1770, there came another problem for the peasants and artisans. It was the English were causing them enough to, you know, their incomes were already cut by half by this time, and this famine had a huge, huge impact on them. So this famine killed about 10 million of people in Bengal. It was a result of the widespread drought combined with the exploitative tax policies of the British government. So we know now that after having the Diwani, after possessing the Diwani, the Britishers were very keen on increasing the revenue, and because of that, they devised a lot of ways to, exploitative ways to, you know, generate taxes, and that taxes were a lot of burden on that peasants and farmers and artisans, and they could not afford to give those taxes. Apart from this, this famine broke their spines. So basically, now they did not even have anything to offer for the revenue, and it broke themselves. So this exploitative policies of the British, it turned out to be very bad, and now there was a certain need of a certain system that could have a, you know, regular assessment and collection of the revenues like previously suggested. But they were not very interested that time because they were lazy, they just wanted the profits. After this famine, the Britishers were they also had, of course, their revenues were cut back for a great instance, because previously, they were being paid, you know, four times more than they were paid before the Diwani. But after the Diwani, after their exploitative taxing system, they were having the revenues four times. But now, because of the famine, the peasants and the farmers and the artisans could not pay that amount back. So basically, the Britishers were also suffering. Okay, suffering is kind of ironically put here. But then the peasants, the artisans were actually suffering, and these could not provide the Britishers with the revenue. So indirectly, the Britishers were also suffering. They wanted to come back with a plan to, you know, have a very uniform kind of tax revenue system. So what all did they do to have this uniform system? There was a certain need to improve the agriculture, because agriculture at that time was the main source of the revenue. So basically, the company introduced the permanent settlement plan, the policy of the permanent settlement in 1793 to encourage the investment in land and to improve the agriculture. Now, what happened in this permanent settlement was, like, there was a revenue that was fixed. Like, if say that for your land, you have to give 12 rupees, that is it. at that time, of course, today 12 rupees would be too less. So basically, at that time, a certain amount of money was fixed. That money was the amount that was to be handed over as the revenue to the Britishers. And that would not be increased or decreased at any cost. So basically, if you're gaining more profit, you don't have to give us more revenue. You can have that. You just have to give the bar at which the permanent settlement has been settled. So that kind of amount was to be given to the Britishers. And they also, in order to improve the investment in land, because Britishers, they were not willing to, you know, be involved themselves into the improvement of the land. So basically, they offered this role to the Rajas and to the Zamindars. So basically, now the Zamindars were the ones who were to collect the revenue from the peasants and the farmers, and they were to pay revenue further to the Britishers. And because of this permanent settlement, the farmers and the peasants, they were to give only a certain sum of amount, which was settled by the permanent settlement. And then that settlement has to be given to the Britishers. The profit was to be there with the Zamindars. So basically, what are the peasants gaining out of this? Okay, the Britishers are having their constant source of revenue. They are having a uniform source. They are having a very, very continuous flow, because that is not, if it is not increasing, it is not also decreasing. But what about those who had to directly pay these taxes? They are the ones who are directly being affected by this. So let's see what happened. Was the agriculture really improved? Now, there were some problems. Of course, we found out one of the problems here only. What were the other problems that were there? The Zamindars here were not investing. They were also not very keen on investing in the lands. When you are getting a constant source of revenue without you being able, without you being the first person who has to do work for, you know, generating this revenue, you are just a middleman. So basically, Zamindar, now you imagine this situation. The Zamindars are just a middleman between the Britishers and the peasants. They were the ones who had to collect the revenue from the peasants, and they were to give the revenue to the Britishers. Whatever the amount that was left, it was left for them. The peasants, they did not have any profit. The Britishers were also having a constant source, but not any profit per se. So these Zamindars, what they did was, they were not very keen on investing in the land. We know now that these Zamindars were the Rajas and the Talukdars. So every areas used to have these Rajas and the Talukdars who were the owners of this huge, vast area of land, and under them, the peasants and the farmers used to work. So now these Rajas and Talukdars of the certain areas, they used to lease out the land to the farmers and all the people who used to work on the land. Now they had to give this money, whatever they produced, they had to give this to the Zamindar and the Talukdars, and they were to give it to the Britishers. They were not very keen on improving the condition of the land, and because of which, the land, of course, produced less. The farmers, they were supposed to give a certain rate, and they could not bear to give that certain rate because, of course, there was no investment on the land. So basically, if you're not investing on the land would not give you anything in return. So land was not giving anything, but the peasants, they were there to, you know, to have the burden of all this. So the Rajas and Talukdars, even when the land was producing more, they were the ones who were gaining profit out of it, because they had to give only a certain sum of amount to the Britishers, and a certain amount of money was coming from the peasants. So because of the, even after the profit, they did not invest on the land, because of which the farmers suffered a great deal. This system failed miserably. So a new system was improvised. An improvised system was implemented. Holt McKenzie, he came up with a solution of this. He thought that, okay, this permanent settlement is not working at all. And here, it is also important for us students to, you know, analyze the situation, which is important for us to gain that what could have happened for these farmers and the peasants who were working during that time. And what were the implications of these policies and laws handled by the Britishers, which were administered by the Britishers? We have three people here. We have, okay, let's see as three kind of groups that are there. First, those who are directly generating the revenue, those who are directly associated with the generation of the revenue by their hard work, they are the peasants and the farmers. They are working on the fields. They are working day and night. They are working their labor. And they are generating a certain amount of money, a fixed sum of which they have to give to the zamindars. And the zamindars, they also have to give a fixed sum to the Britishers. Now, any profit which is there, the peasants and the farmers have to give their produce to the zamindars. The profit which is there, the zamindars are exploiting, and they are not investing in the land. So what is the worst implication of all this on the farmers? They are not able to generate that kind of revenue. So basically it is burdening them. So there were some people who thought that a new system should be there in order to improve the situation of the farmers. So, you know, they could also be involved in the system. So this was introduced by Holt McKenzie in 1822. Revenue of the village, that was called a mahal, was collected by the village headman rather than the zamindar. Now, this village headman, the role of the village headman. At that time, we can assume that the village headman was, you know, the mukhya or sarpanch, which is there in today's time. So basically, the village headman, he had this detail of all the land that was there and who was the owner of the land and who was cultivating the land. Initially, the system was supposed to be a contract between those who were working on the land, that is the peasants and the Britishers. But instead, the Britishers, now again, they chose a middleman that was supposed to be the village headman. And he was to collect the revenue rather than the zamindar, because the zamindars were, you know, not very keen on investing on these lands. And they were very exploitative in their means as well, by extracting all the money from the peasants and everyone. So they were not benefiting, they were not being a means of benefit to the Britishers. So rather, they appointed these village headmen. Sometimes the village headmen were coerced into signing these contracts with the, this is the Monroe system. Let's first see the Mahalwari system. A certain amount of what happened in this Mahalwari system was, here in the Mahalwari system, they took a shift from the permanent settlement system. How they took the shift was, they introduced an assessment. So basically, mahal meant estate. So a group, a number of lands, they constituted a mahal. A number of estates, they constituted a mahal. If the peasants, they had this land in their own name, they were taxed directly. Otherwise, these group of people who held that estate collectively, this area is supposed to be an estate. So basically, this area is supposed to be an estate. I'm sorry. This area, if it's supposed to be an estate, then there could be, you know, certain pieces of land in this. So all these lands, all these shares of land, those who held these lands were supposed to pay a fixed sum. And this assessment, so basically this time the Britishers were keen on, you know, developing an assessment. So they assessed the soil. They assessed the soil, that what kind of soil it was, how fertile it could be, and what are the crops that are being cultivated on these soils, and basically what kind of revenue this soil could generate. So according to that only, this mahal, this whole area, which was called a mahal, the revenue on this mahal was set up. So that was the system of assessment. A land would be called as mahal. Basically, a land or, you know, an area would be, an estate would be called as mahal. This area could be divided into, you know, some people. Those people would have, you know, certain fixed amount of taxes they would have to give according to the assessment which had been done to their land. In the assessment system, that how much the revenue could be produced by this land, and after that only they would have to give this sum and amount to the village headman. Basically, the village headman became the zamindar eventually. So the role of the zamindar was shifted to the village headman, but the village headman had the same responsibilities as that of zamindar, to collect the revenue from the peasants and to give it to the Britishers. So basically, it was a modified kind of system of the zamindari, the permanent settlement system. That was a zamindari system. So after Holt McKenzie, you know, introduced it in 1822, it was further reviewed by Lord William Bentinck. So he also reviewed the system, and this was usually this was over the North India. So basically, this was implied in the North India. Now let's see what happened in the South India. The Munro system. Thomas Munro, who was the governor of Madras, he also came up with a system known as Ryotwari system. The principle of the Munro system was that the company should protect the cultivators, which were also called as Ryots. That is why it was called as Ryotwari system. So in this system also, sometimes the peasants were, they were directly, they were directly brought in to have a contract with the Britishers. Or the other times, the village headman only, he was given this chance. Instead of protecting the Ryots, what happened was, what I meant by the middleman here, what I meant by the village headman here, basically the village headman was not in any role here, but in this Ryotwari system, the land was segregated. The land was segregated in the Mahalwari system as well. So the land was assessed and it was segregated on the basis of the revenue it could produce. And then the revenue was, the share of the revenue was fixed at some percentage of share, which could be held by the zamindar, and the rest of the shares was supposed to be given to the Britishers. Now here, it was thought that the company should protect the cultivators, but rather than protecting the cultivators, what happened was the rate of the revenue was held up so high that even in this system, the cultivators were unable to pay that kind of money. So basically, the rate was, held over as 60% for the wetlands and 50% for the dry lands. Whatever the revenue that has been generating, 60% of that revenue was to be given to the Britishers, and 50% of the revenue for the dry lands were to be given to the Britishers. Here, the peasants were directly involved with the Britishers. The contract was directly between the peasants, the owners of the land, and the Britishers. The owners, that is, the owners of the land, they could sell or mortgage the property as well. They could, lease also. They could rent the property also. They could have under tenants. So the problem of under tenants also arose, because the peasants were not able to generate that kind of income. So they wanted to, run away from this, because that was impossible for them to produce. The amount of money that should have been invested in the land for a greater fertility was not being invested, and rather whole of the revenue that was coming as the result of the produce was, declining. Of course, at some point of time, we have seen in geography that after some point of time, the fertility of the soil decreases if you don't invest in it. So basically, after a few years, it was, producing less and less revenue for the farmers. And the farmers were unable to bear the pay of these wetlands and the dry lands. Basically, the Ryotwari revenue, they were unable to pay. And if they were unable to pay, under this Ryotwari system, the British were to annex those lands and, sell it to someone else. So that happened a lot. Basically, a lot of peasants, they were very, very unable to, produce this kind of revenue. So they leased it out to the under tenants. The under tenants were supposed to work. They were to give these revenues. The under tenants were also unable to give that kind of revenue to these Ryots, to the Britishers. The headman, of course, became here also, headman had no role. But since the cost of the revenue was so high, that there was a need to, have this kind of middlemen, which were supposed to be the money lenders. So basically, the peasants needed the money lenders to procure that amount of money, which was supposed to be given from them to the Britishers. So that happened. Basically, this system also failed, because instead of thinking about the plight of the peasants and the farmers, they were just thinking about their profit, their business. They were just thinking about their trade, because they were just interested that their continuous flow of income should not be decreased at any cost. So this was basically nothing about protecting the Ryots. It only protected the interest of the Britishers. The problem with the Ryotwari system, of course, we have seen what are the problems that were there. Officials fixed extremely high revenue demands. This was the first problem. Of course, instead of having low revenue demands, even after assessment of those lands, even after assessment of what kind of revenue that land could generate, the revenue demand was set up as very high. So the peasants were unable to pay those kinds of revenues. which farmers were unable to pay. This forced peasants and ryots to leave the countryside and migrate in search of work. Many of those peasants, they sold their land. Those land were, you know, auctioned off. Many of those peasants, they leased those lands to the under tenants. So basically, at any cost, they were not able to produce that kind of revenue to the Britishers. So both of the system, the permanent settlement system and the Ryotwari as well as Mahalwari system, it failed miserably. We have to understand here that why these system failed. This system failed because they failed to understand the plight of the farmers and the peasants. Had they understood the plight of the farmers, decreased the kind of revenue that was accessed from the farmers, it was a possibility that the farmers, you know, would have invested more in the land, then the land would have been more fertile, and they would not have to take money from the money lenders. They would not have to give such amount of revenue, and basically the land could produce more. So that is how the revenue could have been increased. But instead of going this way, they just wanted a regular flow, regular and continuous flow of income. Because of that, both of the system failed miserably.